So Shalini will talk about glaucoma cases, primary glaucoma, operated filter, secondary glaucoma. Dr. Shalini, any cases keep for us? Keep for us the case, your questions, we'll answer them. Thank you.
Good morning, delegates and student and respected dignitaries on the dais. At the outset, I would thank Dr. Kirti for this opportunity to interact with you residents. So just now you saw a wonderful video of how to examine your patients. Now, examination is extremely important, and to identify the clinical features is equally important. Even if you are not able to make the diagnosis, doesn't matter. But if you miss a finding, then definitely it is going to matter. So let's see how and what to see in a glaucoma case. Now, first and foremost thing is, you know, the history part is extremely important. In glaucoma, you might not be getting any symptoms. In primary open angle glaucoma, there might not be any symptoms, or maybe some brow ache or hemicranial headache. There might be history of frequent change of near glasses. Then family history of glaucoma is also very important, so you need to emphasize that. And then obviously refractive errors might be associated with glaucoma, so you need to ask the patients regarding the spectacles. Not just this, there are some other associated things which might be associated with glaucoma, like history of steroid usage, history of trauma to eye, or any other secondary disease like uveitis, any intracranial disease, and then you know that normal tension glaucoma can be associated with systemic disorders. Sleep apnea might also be responsible for progression of glaucoma. So you need to record all these findings in your history. And if it is not there, you can say that it is negative or about these findings. Well, you know that systemic medications, they do cause glaucoma, and not just steroids, other antidepressants, they might also lead to acute angle closure glaucoma, and therefore you must note down what all medication patient is using. Now let's go to examination. We need to do comprehensive examination, record visual acuity, and then detailed examination I will be discussing in subsequent slides. So what are the cardinal measurements which we do in glaucoma? We might not be needing any sophisticated instrument to diagnose a patient of glaucoma, but yes, we need to do a good applanation tonometry. Second is, we need to do gonioscopy to find out whether it is an open angle or a closed angle glaucoma. Third, a 90D examination on slit lamp, that is stereoscopic view of the disc. And finally, the visual field. So when we talk of visual acuity, it is not important only to measure it on Snellen's chart, but you need to check the perception of projection of rays also. Because sometimes the vision might be perfectly all right, he might be reading 6-6, but because of constriction of visual field, the projection of rays might be defective. So you need to record those findings also. Then diffuse light examination is very, very important. Just throw your torch on the face of the patient and see that there might be sometimes dilated episcleral vessels, as you see in the second photograph, or there might be a red eye in the patient who is having headache, vomiting and everything, and then you see a red eye, then the diagnosis which comes to your mind is acute angle closure glaucoma, right? So these kind of findings you will see on diffuse light examination. Similarly, a child who is having capillary hemangioma like this might be a case of Sturge-Weber syndrome, or a patient with this kind of nevus might be a case of nevus of Ota. So do an external eye examination, which is extremely important. And then simultaneously you are using a torch, do a pupillary reaction also. Sometimes in cases of advanced glaucomatous optic neuropathy, you might see that patient is having a relative afferent pupillary defect. Then coming to slit lamp examination, go from anterior to posterior. Just now you saw in the video shown by Dr. Kirti that we need to see one structure at one go, like for conjunctiva, go to cornea and then to anterior chamber. So regarding cornea, you must see what from the anterior layer of the cornea till posterior layers of cornea. You might be seeing a case of corneal edema. You might be seeing a Krukenberg spindles like this, indicating a pigmentary glaucoma, right? Similarly, in the lower photograph, you can see keratic precipitates, which might be associated with iridocyclitis, or you might see a congenital buthelmos eye like this, having a tram track appearance, and that signifies that patient is buthelmos. Then don't forget to raise the eyelids. Sometimes what we do, we simply go and see with the slit lamp and we see the eye and then we forget to raise the upper eyelid. It is very, very important because sometimes our laser iridotomy might be hiding under the eyelids, or sometimes there might be a filter, a bleb, which is hiding beneath the eyelids. So you must never miss doing this procedure. Now coming to anterior chamber depth, Van Herrick's is the procedure which is done for screening. You have to make a thin slit lamp beam at the limbus and then check the depth of the cornea and the anterior chamber. And then you can compare the depth of the anterior chamber and you can decide whether it is shallow or not. Coming to iris, iris is extremely important because you might see posterior synechia or you might see irisotrophic patches indicating that there might be a previous attack of subacute angle closure, or patient is having viral keratouveitis, or you might see a fuchs heterochromic iridocyclitis like this. Similarly, you might see transillumination defect which indicate a pigmentary glaucoma. Now, not just iris, you must see the margin of the pupil, which is extremely important. Now here you can see that there is a normal pupillary ruff. If there is any deficiency in the pupillary ruff, you know that there might be a subacute attack which has led to loss of pupillary reflex, or you might see this kind of white chalk-like deposits at the pupillary margin, and you know this is a case of pseudo-exfoliative glaucoma. In traumatic glaucoma, you might see that there is a mid-dilated pupil with loss of sphincter, and then sometimes you might be seeing a neovascular glaucoma. So margin of the pupillary is extremely important for you all. After this, we need to do the examination of lens. Now, it is important to do dilated examination except in cases where you suspect angle closure, because in dilated examination, you might see these kind of ring, and you know what are these rings signifying? Pseudo-exfoliative syndrome, right? Similarly, here you can see that there are so many pigments at the anterior lens capsule. Now, here you can see there are subcapsular opacities, just as you see in glaucoma flecken, that indicating that there was a previous acute angle closure attack. Or sometimes you might see this kind of washer's ring indicating a traumatic cataract. Then obviously you might be seeing a subluxated lens like this. So lens examination not just gives the diagnosis, but also gives you the etiology behind the glaucoma or what is going inside the eyes. Now, as I have to cover the operated filter also, so it might be in immediate post-operative period, like after you have done your trabeculectomy surgery. So doing a Seeder's test is very, very important. Sometimes you might be seeing a Seeder's positive like this, as you see here. And that means that if it is an immediate post-operative period, you need to intervene there and then and close this conjunctiva so that you don't have Seeder's positive. If it is in late phase of trabeculectomy, that you might be having a weeping bleb, and that is, there is likelihood of infection, and therefore you need to again intervene in this particular situation. Well, in operated filter, you might be having a failed bleb like this. Now, once you are having a failed bleb like this, you need to do a gonioscopy. And if you see that there is an ostium which is patent like this, you know that yes, needling of the bleb will help in this particular patient. So you go ahead and do the needling. But suppose you have a closed ostium like this, then you know now no needling is going to help and you need to do another trabeculectomy surgery. So it is not just about diagnosis, it is also about managing your patients by just simple examination and simple tools all you are having. Sometimes you might be having overhanging blebs like this, and you can see thin wall cystic bleb, and this might be again a foci for infection. Then you can assess the bleb morphology also, that whether there are presence of microcysts, whether you have, what are the amount of conjunctival vessel, whether it is a avascular bleb, or the shape of the vessels, like if they are corkscrew vessels, that means that there is likelihood of failure, presence of encapsulation and height of the bleb. Now let's see, this is a avascular bleb. Here you can see a failing bleb with few of the conjunctival vessels. Here you can see a slightly angry looking bleb, and this is the typical corkscrew vessels which are indicating that this trabeculectomy procedure is likely to failure. So you need to give certain antimitotic drugs to prevent this vascularization. Now, gonioscopy, as I have been emphasizing, is extremely important to make your diagnosis. So you need to see all the structures starting from Schwell baseline, trabecular meshwork, scleral spur, ciliary body band, and root of iris. Now, gonioscopy is the procedure which you all must learn, and you need to identify the findings also. So like here, you can see there are peripheral anterior synechia. There are peripheral anterior synechia like this, or you might be having angle recession glaucoma like this. You might be having a hiding ciliary body tumor or a foreign body like this. So again, documentation, as just now we talked, is extremely important. If you have a peripheral anterior synechia, you need to draw it with the help of a orange color. Regarding depigmentation is purple, pigmentation is white surrounded by a black line, and then blood vessels, they are red in color. So you need to draw your diagram, label it properly so that it gives you a recording and you can maintain your data. Regarding intraocular pressure, Goldman applanation tonometer is the gold standard. You must clean and properly, then only you make sit the patient. Don't forget to clean the tonometer properly. Explain the patient and take a proper consent. Now, dilated disc examination is extremely important, especially if you are doing with any of the lenses, you need to multiply it with magnification factor. Red-free examination you must do, and then again document your findings like this. If you don't, just one slide more. So you need to document your findings like this. If you can't take a photograph, but you can always draw a diagram like this, write down the size of the disc and the vessels, and then you can document your finding. So visual field examination is a separate talk, but you must all know about this. And so to conclude, I would say it involves a strategic approach. Comprehensive eye examination, including slit lamp, IOP, gonioscopy, and dilated disc examination, and then correlate your findings with visual field. Thank you so much.